So, Killers of the Flower Moon, Martin Scorsese, going to pull out the story structure or go over it in a way that allows me to pull out some of the elements, but doesn't make it too complicated in a 5 or 10 minute video, which this will turn out to be. But you'll see that it can very quickly become quite messy in terms of when it's pulled out, or when we try and go over it. So these things have to be normally done, through a series of workshops. So you'll see that it follows the basic structure. Let's go over basic story architecture first, and then we'll apply it to this film. So basic story architecture: when you first start writing and filmmaking, you have a linear perspective in that sense. Pretty soon you realize that both the beginning and the ending are the same, which is why we demonstrate story structure via a loop. We identify the classic beginning and ending as a state of perfection or paradise, if you like, and that devolves to the state of imperfection, a limitations phase, or paradise lost, if you like. And then the process of returning to it, in essence, is undergone. You can start there, or somewhere in between. If you do that, the events that tend to be referenced at later stages. Most stories end with a state of perfection, paradise, various other ways of describing it, freedom to live. If you don't want to do that, if you want to end with imperfection or some combination, that's almost irrelevant. The process is always the same. So you're always going to have transformation, change, metamorphosis, transmogrification, the various arcs, psychological journey. You're always going to have physical journey, and you're always moving through new worlds, which are physical manifestations of new psychological states and new versions of the self. Working your way around the cycle involves jumping through lots of hoops. Each hoop has its own set of sub-stages, which in essence are functions which may be performed, messages which you may communicate that tell you what tangibles or intangibles to pull out, and so on. So, for example, if that's the ordinary world, we know it's a state of protection, fear of exit, repression, etc. So those sub-stages show you how to construct those sequences. When you're here, you're unable to return. You have to go forward, go all the way around until you're ready to return. That's basic story architecture. It's the fundamental framework that all stories follow. On a whiteboard, as you can see, it starts to look a bit messy, but once you get your head around it, it's actually not that, it provides a lot of clarity. So let's get rid of this, okay, and let's draw another loop. So we know now that there's much more behind that loop than a simple circle would suggest. So, Killers of the Flower Moon, let's leave aside for a second that it's Martin Scorsese. Let's leave aside for a second that it's a 3.5 hour film. Let's leave aside that it's historical. It tells of the heinous acts committed against the Osage Indians. Let's look at it from the point of construction and engineering the story. And if you do that, then it's actually a straightforward murder mystery. So we've got two characters and obviously the classic arcs that characters go through. So we come into it and we've got our two characters. Let's call Ernest R. Let's call him our okay, let's just call him our protagonist, right, for the sake of convenience. And let's call him King, his uncle, the antagonist. So you've got two characters. One essentially, Ernest, essentially a good man, and our uncle, obviously, not a good man, and they are pretty much aligned. And so what's going to happen is we're going to take our protagonist all the way around, and we're going to turn him to align him to the antagonist. Now, at the stage of the atonement, classically, he's going to have to make a choice, which is what he does in these letting go phases. So initially, we meet our characters, we've learned the history. So the Osage peoples are the wealthiest in the world because they've been fortunate enough to, oil has been discovered in their on their lands, and there has been an effort to rob them of their wealth, and we're going to tell that story. So we meet our characters here. We learn all of that as we go into this. We meet various other characters. So, for example, Ernest's brother. And then we've got the encouragement. Again, you've got the uncle acting as a supernatural aid. Again, showing that, you know, characters don't have to stick or be one archetype. They can perform multiple or be multiple archetypes. In other words, archetypes are a kind of function. And a character can perform many functions. And the suggestion is, why don't you get married? And so that happens. So by the time we enter our first threshold, we've got Ernest is married to Molly. And then we find out, as we start to then arc around, who these characters really are. So we've got our uncle, our king, saying, look, it's all about property rights. And getting the head rights, and we've got our protagonist changing. So he starts off with thievery and muggings and robbery, and he starts taking part with his brother in stealing the wealth of the Indians in on a minor level. And then by the time we get around to the belly of the whale, we realize actually we're going much further. We're starting to kill the Indians. So we start off with Molly's sister, and then any kind of investigation attempt to stop that will be also the retribution will be taken, and they'll and that's shown by them killing the investigator and anybody that tries to solve these mysteries. So lots of murders without investigation. And then, and what happens here is the incremental past the first threshold separation, we've got him Ernest arcing from simple thievery to actually taking part in the murders. Then we go to the physical separation. And again, what we're doing is we're arcing the protagonist, we're arcing Ernest around, and we've got many more murders of Molly's family and tribe, including her mother and and Ernest takes part in those, and then we've got her in essence going to DC to try and get help. And part of the Road to Trial section here is that it's not just King, but you've got lots of people collaborating with him to try and extract the Indians' wealth. And then, in terms of two journeys, the second part of the journey starts, and the deeper choices have to be made. So here we've got Incident arriving, and here we've got King telling his nephew Ernest to start giving his own wife Incident. And we've got the arc in terms of the power play between the two demonstrated again here in the belly of the whale, where King spanks his nephew. And again, at these stages, all these stages, you've got our protagonist having to make a choice and connecting to the underlying theme, which I'm not going to go into here. We have him, our protagonist, making those wrong choices. By the time we get to see the tangible sword stage, we've got the FBI arriving to try and bring us back to some kind of normal state. We have our underworld sequences and our near-death experience sequences, where we've got everybody who's associated with it is being murdered in some way, shape or form and taken out of the equation. And then ultimately we come back round, we've got the FBI arriving, and we've got at the stage of the atonement, we've got White, the leader of the FBI, asking him to make a choice. Which side does he want to be on? He's a good man. He agrees he is a good man, and he's become or come under the influence of a very bad man, his uncle, and he decides to turn. Here we have the choice. You've got a pull and a push between the FBI saying make the right decision, and you've got the Kings or the whole, everybody who's collaborating, pushing him to not testify, until ultimately you've got the letting go, which is the door of his death, which causes him to let go and then testify. And then we basically come back and everybody lets go, all the characters let go. So we've got Molly letting go of Ernest, and we come back around to some form of freedom to live. There's lots more going on under there. So, for example, we've got the silence. I mean, thematically, the silence that is representative of the Osage Indians versus the materialism represented by the by King and his collaborators, and the link to the theme. But again, you know, just showing you how these stories follow this process of journey and change and arc and transformation and theme, and how archetypes are involved, how we're moving characters from one side to another side, how certain characters represent a side, how choices have to be made, and moving from this state limitations of chaos, and then back around. If you want a detailed deconstruction of that story, as with all the others, you can order it off the website. But once again, this whole process has gone over in detail in the 2100 Stage Hero's Journey Transformation, Movement Through New Worlds and States, which you can purchase off the website.